The gospel of this morning brings us to a unique account, an account that is only mentioned in the gospel of St. Luke, the rising of the son of the widow of Nain. Again, in the midst of a crowd, two crowds really, that converge on one location at the gate, and in the midst of all the noise and the chaos, some are weeping, some are joyful. They're two very different crowds, but in the midst of this chaotic scene, it's unplanned, it's unscheduled. Had either crowd been there just 5 minutes earlier or 5 minutes later, they would have passed each other, but not really met at that bottleneck, if you will, at that entrance to the city. And in the midst of all of the chaos, in the midst of all of the tumult, these two crowds descending and out from opposite directions, you see that Christ stops and he is concerned with one individual. He is concerned with a lonely, weeping woman. Sometimes we kind of tend to lose track of God's love for us, of his care for us. Sometimes even in our language, when we talk about God, it seems sometimes that our language puts him at a greater distance from us than bring him closer. We often speak about God loving humanity, and we kind of speak in the abstract. He was incarnate in order to save humanity. What we need to keep in mind is that he wasn't only incarnate to save humanity, but he was incarnate to save humans. He was incarnate to save each and every one of us. It's hard not to be lost in the numbers sometimes. I'm sure that at some point with this last period, you've seen at least footage on the news or something of the World Series. When they pan to the crowd, when they pan to that massive stadium, just massive numbers of people. How huge that is, how massive that is. If we imagine that we are one within that massive crowd, and what does God care for me? By human reasoning, that doesn't even do it justice. Because by human reasoning, to account for all of humans on earth, for every individual, you have to think about that massive stadium that was just filled to the brim. And you need 150,000 of those, each of them as packed, each of them as huge, to understand the scale. Our minds can't really process it. After a while, we just kind of think about numbers as numbers, but you don't really stop and think about individuals. We think that in some ways that because of all these numbers and how massive the numbers are, that we get distracted, we forget, and frankly overwhelmed by simply trying to understand the numbers. The mistake we often make is that we kind of reduce God to our line of thinking, and we think about God, well, what does God care about me? 1 out of 7 some odd billion. God cares about us because he's an infinite God. The one thing that can outstretched any number is the infinity of God. God assures us over and over again that he is not just simply a savior of humanity, but that he is a savior of each and every one of us. To Isaiah, when he met Isaiah, Isaiah tells us, "The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me." And a few verses later, God speaks to him and tells him, "See, I have inscribed you on the palm of my hands." Is that individual attention that he gives us, that he, in the midst of that crowd, focused on that poor widow. In Jeremiah, there is an even more remarkable account. He tells him, "Tell Jeremiah, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Now, this can get a little bit technical, but it's really not. When you look at the Septuagint here, when you look at the translation here, the Greek here, Greek is very rich language. There's several ways of expressing knowledge. But to know something like you know who your parents are, that's one type of knowledge. You know your grade in school, that's another type of knowledge. But the word that is used here for God knowing us, epistemai, is complete knowledge, total knowledge. This is the knowledge of, I know that 2 + 2 = 4. It is complete, it is absolute, it is unchangeable. When the scriptures, when the Bible tells us that God knows us, it is not knowing us as a face in the crowd, it is not knowing us as 1 out of 7 billion, he knows us to that exactness, almost that mathematical precision and exactness that only he can know. He knows us better than we even know ourselves. And here in the midst of this crowd, in the midst of this tumult, you see Christ stopping and focusing on that one woman. The gospel of this morning brings us to a very chaotic place, a place of anxiety, a place filled with contradictions. It brings us to a village called Nain. Now, Nain means something along the lines of pleasantness, of joy, the pleasant. Nain is a cognate of the Arabic Naim. When we speak about Ferdowsi Naim, it's that same word in Naim. Just linguistics between Arabic and Hebrew, the Ain goes silent. But in this village called Pleasant, there was nothing really pleasant that morning. In that village called Joy, this morning we have a weeping widow going out to bury her young son. A widow, in general, throughout world history and in most places around the globe, even in our world today, women tend to fare worse than men. In this time, in this society, this is her beloved son, but she also loses not only her son, she loses her guardian, she loses her support, she loses her one son. And her one son, her only son, dies as a young man. When you look at the tragedy here, when you look at the sorrow here in this village called Pleasant, in this village called Joy, it is compounded. It's one miserable thing after another, one on top of another. When we look this morning at this village called Joy, this village called the Pleasant, we only see weeping, we only see sorrow and loss. And we meet the widow, we meet that weeping widow at the gate of that city as the two crowds are coming together, two large crowds. And the language of the scripture here is very descriptive. Christ is coming, and he is coming with a large crowd following him, and she is leaving with the body of her son with a huge crowd following her, and those two crowds again meet at the gate. Both of them are noisy, and both of them couldn't really be any more different. The crowd following Christ, they are following, if nothing else, even if they don't comprehend who he is, they are following what they believe is a prophet. They're following what is a miracle worker. They're a buzz about the Lord of glory. The crowd following the woman, on the other hand, they're sorrow. They are dealing with loss. They are dealing with death, the death of the boy, the sorrow of his mother, and the mother who probably wishes that she were dead. even their trajectory, where they are walking. They are walking in opposite directions. With Christ, with that joyful crowd, he is walking into that village called Pleasant with that woman, with that widow, walking out of the village called Pleasant. Now, if you just stop and looked at them as they are leaving the village, it's hard not to think that, or to remember a similar event that took place way back in history. Because as she's walking out from the village of Pleasant, you can't tell if they're walking or they're being kicked out of the village. If you think about all the way back to Adam and Eve, the same way that the woman is leaving the village literally named Joy, Adam and Eve were leaving the paradise of joy. And as she was weeping, they were weeping because even though she had her son who had died, they had attained the sentence of death for them and all of their progeny. All of their children are bound to die. All of their children physically die. But they meet Christ. Whether we are looking at that widow coming out of the city or we are thinking back all the way back more allegorically to Adam and Eve, at the gate, at that point of transition, at that point of no return, they meet Christ. And out of his pure love, his pure grace, he decides to act. Now, whether in the woman in the gospel this morning or whether with Adam and Eve, there is no request. Nobody tells God, well, could you please mitigate this punishment? Help me here. Nobody says anything. With this woman, as he did all the way back with Abraham, just simply out of his love, out of his compassion, he acts and he remedies. For both of them, that sentence of death is lifted. The son of the widow is raised. More importantly, through his actions, all of the sons of Eve, all the sons and daughters of Eve are raised. And their sorrow had been turned into joy. We start off looking at the gospel with two crowds running in opposite directions, having a different demeanor altogether. One of sorrow, one of pain, the other one of rejoicing. And as the two meet at that gate, they become one. They become one in demeanor and they become one in direction. All are joyous now as the boy is raised. All are ecstatic. And all of them are walking in one direction. All of them now are walking into that village called Joy, into that village called the Pleasant. That village called Joy has been effectively turned into an earthly paradise, into the paradise of joy. Because on that day, in that village, there was no death. On that day in that village, there is only joy. And they have Christ. They have Christ in their midst. Where there is Christ, there can only be shouts of joy. Where there is Christ, there is only life. As we rejoice this morning and as we celebrate the Eucharist and we celebrate the raising of the son of that widow, we also have to celebrate the raising of ourselves, of the sacrifice of Christ for us, and that he lifted that sentence of death from us. Because without Christ, we are both that widow who is in a miserable state, and we are that dead child. And as we celebrate the Eucharist, and celebrate his resurrection, But we also celebrate ours. The fact that he does not keep, the source of life does not keep life to himself, but he gives this to us. And he gives this to us freely. Every Sunday, every single Sunday, we partake of this miracle. We enact this miracle, or even at least a shadow of this miracle. We can think of the nave of the church as Nain, as the nave is where we congregate, where we are sitting now. But that nave is Nain. It is the nave of the church. It should be a place of joy and pleasantness, and yet when we come into church, oftentimes we are coming dead. We are burying our dead, whether it's us, whether it's a friend, whether it's a relative. The tears, if not external, at least internal, for our sins, for what we have done. But at the gate we meet Christ. Our gate is this gate. It's the royal door. Now, because of the numbers and what have you, we're used to kind of taking communion, especially on Sundays, from the sides. But traditionally, communion comes out of the royal door. And then sometimes we do this in smaller liturgies and in major feasts when we have more than one individual that can provide the body and the blood. But communion comes out of that gate, and you meet Christ at that gate. Christ is coming from the altar to Nain, and we from Nain walking out. And we meet him at that gate. We meet him at that royal door. And as we commune, as we partake of him, as we encounter Christ as that widow encountered Christ, he now provides us with life. From that point on, the nave doesn't just simply become an image of Nain, of Naim. It becomes an image of paradise, of the paradise of joy. Because from that point on, there is no death. Because once we have communed, whether in the flesh, whether in the spirit, we are in Christ. There is no death. There is only joy because not only are we in Christ, but we have Christ in our midst and death has been abolished. In the nave, before the liturgy and before our communion, we come with our tears, we come with our sorrows, we come with our dead. And as we meet Christ at the gate, as we meet him, he turns that into joy. And once again, we are not walking in opposite directions, but we are walking in the same direction, in joy, into that village called peace, that village called joy. Glory be to God forever.